Now, those arguments suggest that you could have mutual deterrence with nuclear weapons, that nuclear weapons could produce a stable balance of terror. And yet, if you look at the operational requirements historically, it's been far more difficult to achieve stability. You need to have four different things for a mutual deterrence to hold. First, you have to avoid preventive war during a transition period. By this, I mean that you have to avoid going to war with one state starting the war before the other state has enough nuclear weapons to actually create a condition of assured destruction. During that early transition period, one side has an incentive to go to war. And indeed, militaries may be particularly interested in starting a war during this period of time, because if you're a military, organizational dynamics suggests you want to be decisive in using force, and you want to go to war when you have the advantage rather than wait for a more balanced period where you might lose. Second, you must develop survivable second strike forces. That's easier said than done for organizational reasons, as I'll describe in a moment. Sometimes organizations produce survivable second strike forces, and sometimes military organizations fail to do so. Third, even if you have a stable, in quotes, nuclear condition, you might have an accident, a false warning that could produce a nuclear war. So the third requirement is to prevent accidents that could lead to an accidental war. And lastly, even if you have some semblance of stability at the nuclear level, some state might still be interested in using conventional forces, precisely because they think that there is stability at the nuclear level and the other side might not retaliate. Why not use conventional forces? How can you use nuclear weapons to deter conventional conflicts if you have mutually assured destruction? Now, there are some who argue that more may be better, as political scientist Ken Waltz has argued. Deterrence is simple because of the logic of the nuclear revolution. And yet, I want to remind everyone that nuclear weapons are not controlled by pristine rational states. They're controlled by normal, imperfect human beings inside normal, imperfect organizations. So let's walk through each of these: the problem of preventive war, survivable second strike forces, preventing accidental war, and managing the stability-instability paradox, to show that not just rational actors, but rather complex organizations are involved here. And that makes nuclear stability a much harder thing to achieve. Now, if the theory is right, the United States should have been interested, or at least contemplate, engaging in an attack on the Soviet Union before the Soviet Union got nuclear weapons. And indeed, history suggests that that's the case. The National Security Council, under the Truman administration, published a top-secret document, NSC 68, that explicitly discusses whether the United States should engage in a preventive attack, starting a war before the Soviet Union got nuclear weapons. And as the quote on the right suggests, NSC 68 found that even if we attacked first, we could destroy the Soviet Union, but Soviet military forces were so strong that they would take over Western Europe, and there'd be a long and difficult struggle. Moreover, NSC 68 argued that the American public would not support an initiation of a war of that nature. So the Truman administration explicitly ruled against using nuclear weapons in a preventive war, suggesting that perhaps if the Soviet Union was about to start a war, we might preempt by attacking first, but we weren't going to deliberately start a preventive attack on the Soviet Union. And when a political leader decides not to engage in preventive war, that does not mean that the military is not still pushing for a preventive war. Indeed, after Truman made the explicit decision that the United States would not engage in preventive war, Major General Orville Anderson, the commandant of the Air Force Air War College, said to the New York Times, "Give me the order to do it, and I can break up Russia's 5 atomic bomb nests in a week. And when I went up to Christ, I think I explained to him that I had saved civilization. Now, Truman fired Orville Anderson for making such a statement, and yet interest in preventive war did not stop with Orville Anderson. Indeed, well into the 1950s, Air Force documents suggest that the military was interested in continuing to engage in preventive war options. You see here a document by Air Force Chief of Staff, the General Twining, to the fellow Joint Chiefs of Staff, that argued that if, before entering the second part of time, if our objectives have not been achieved by means short of general war, it will be necessary to adopt other resources. We must recognize the time of decision, or we will continue blindly down a suicidal path and arrive at a situation in which we will have entrusted our survival to the whims of a small group of proven barbarians. And so Twining argued that it would be really important for the military to take such decisions as might involve general war. Now, this is really sadly ironic. Twining's calling the Soviet Union barbarians, which in many ways, I think if you look at their behavior, they were. And yet he was advocating a major preventive nuclear attack on the Soviet Union, which would have destroyed, by estimates of the time, 118 out of 134 major cities in the Soviet Union, causing approximately 60 million deaths. The second problem of creating stability with nuclear weapons is the problem of survivability. I noted before that optimists about nuclear stability think that having a small number of nuclear weapons that are second strike survivable is an easy thing to do. And yet, militaries create standard operating procedures. They operate in ways that produce signatures. They do the same thing over and over again for the sake of coordination. And they create what intelligence officers call a signature, that you can, if you know enough about the organization, you can begin to understand what it's doing. And military signatures can give away even secret operations. So the picture you see here is from the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis, where the Soviet Union was putting surface-to-air missiles around missile sites in Cuba in a secret operation, a covert deployment, and yet deployed the surface-to-air missiles with easily seen Star David patterns, just as they had done in the Soviet Union, which helped us understand where the missile sites were. Their efforts to create an easy standard operating procedure for their military created a signature that gave their operation away. Here's a picture of another example. How did the United States know where Soviet ICBMs were inside the Soviet Union? Finding an ICBM, which is basically a dot, a small silo in the middle of a vast country, is hard. But the Soviet military put three security fences around each one, and then had a road with a wide radius turn, as you can see in the upper right-hand side. And that was to be able to get a missile on a truck, take the curve, put the missile inside. Building secure second strike forces is harder because we could actually figure out where their ICBMs were because of this operational pattern or the signature. The third requirement for mutual assured destruction to be stable is not to have an accidental nuclear war. Now, the good news is that we never had an accidental nuclear war. The bad news is that there are historical cases that raise the risk and should create concerns. One I'd like to point to is in 1962, again during the Cuban Missile Crisis, the United States routinely kept a small number of ICBMs with test warheads, not nuclear warheads, but radios and other kind of equipment that we could launch an ICBM from Vandenberg Air Force Base in California to the Kwajalein Atoll. And we did that to keep knowing how accurate our missiles were and how reliable our missiles were. or during the Cuban Missile Crisis because we were concerned that a war might break out, the Air Force put actual nuclear warheads on 9 of the 10 missiles and then shifted their aim point from the Kwajalein Atoll in the Marshall Islands in the Pacific to aim it at China and the Soviet Union. And then in the middle of the night, right at the height of the crisis, the United States launched an ICBM against the Kwajalein Atoll. We did launch the right one, the one that only had the radios and the test equipment. But think of the risk that would have happened if the Soviet Union had figured out that we had loaded up those weapons. Accidental nuclear war is hard to prevent. The fourth condition is to make sure that you can manage the stability-instability paradox. If you have nuclear weapons, and both sides have nuclear weapons, how can you stop another country or credibly deter another country from engaging in a conventional attack when it's not credible that you're going to retaliate with nuclear weapons because they have nuclear weapons to retaliate against you? Well, again, Thomas Schelling, Nobel laureate economist, had a wonderful theory, a suggestion that you could engage and develop threats that leave something to chance. As Schelling put it, a country can threaten to stumble into a war even if it cannot credibly threaten to invite one. In fact, though a country may not be able with absolute credibility to threaten general war, it may be equally unable to, with absolute credibility, to forestall a major war. So here, the logic was that the Soviet Union might attack NATO, thinking that the United States wouldn't respond. And so NATO, in response, put tactical nuclear weapons along the border, in part because they might be used even if the president didn't want to use them. As Schelling also wrote, if brinksmanship means anything, it means manipulating the shared risk of war. It means exploiting the danger that somebody might inadvertently go over the brink, dragging the other with him. If two climbers are tied together and one wants to intimidate the other by seeming about to fall over the edge, it has to have some uncertainty or anticipated irrationality, or it won't work. If the brink is clearly marked and provides a firm footing, no loose pebbles underfoot, and no gusts of wind to catch one off guard, if each climber is in fully control of himself, never gets dizzy, neither can pose any risk to the other by approaching the brink. So this is actually what the United States did, putting nuclear weapons along the border, giving the capability, not always the authority, but the capability to commanders to use them, what was called the use it or lose it situation, so that no Soviet military commander using conventional attacks on NATO, on Western Europe, could be sure that the United States wouldn't take a risk that left something to chance and nuclear weapons would be used regardless of what the president wanted to do. And so here you see photograph of an Honest John surface-to-surface missile. This one is being tested at the White Sands Missile Range in New Mexico, but these short-range nuclear weapons were deployed throughout Western Europe. Under mutually assured destruction, we created a threat that left something to chance. That might be good to enhance deterrence, but it was also risky